Support for Digging Deeper comes from the Penn State Alumni Association, connecting alumni to the university and to each other. The Alumni Association is powered by Pride. Learn more at alumni.psu.edu. The Penn State Bookstore, now in an expanded location in the Hub Robeson Center, improving the student experience at Penn State with philanthropic support for student causes throughout the university. And from viewers like you. Thank you.
Through the Invent Penn State initiative, the university has launched numerous programs aimed at driving innovation and entrepreneurship. In this edition of Digging Deeper, Penn State President Eric Barron will explore how these efforts are impacting the state's economy. He's joined by Dennis Davin, Pennsylvania Secretary of Community and Economic Development. I'll be back later on in the show to talk one-on-one with President Barron about how the Penn State initiative is going and where it's headed. Now, here's President Barron.
Well, thank you so much for joining me today.
Absolutely.
I've been looking forward to it. So you've been in office since 2015?
2015, yeah.
And what were your priorities?
So coming in to office then with the governor focused really on three things as part of his platform, and that was jobs that pay, schools that teach, and then government that works. Our part obviously was the jobs that pay. So we focused specifically on doing what we could do to help the climate for job creation and job expansion here in Pennsylvania. And we've been focused on that ever since.
Yeah, so is Pennsylvania a good place to bring your company or start a company?
It is a great place. Mm-hmm. And I have to say that. I'm paid to say
right,
that.
But it is
a great place. Yeah. So one of the things that we do is that we started early in 2015, and we've been doing this for the last 2 years, is looking at opportunities to market Penn State, or mm-hmm. market Penn State.
That's
absolutely
fine.
Yeah, that's
you,
good for you
go
right.
For it. Yep.
Market Penn State, but also market Pennsylvania to an organization of site selectors. So site selectors are a group of they could be accounting firms, other types of corporate firms that work with companies when they're looking to expand their operations,
mm-hmm.
or when they're looking to locate certain operations in different areas of the country. So we've been going all throughout the country, actually, and having meetings with these site selectors and talking about Pennsylvania and, mm-hmm. and what Pennsylvania has to offer. And a lot of places really, folks like me and economic development professionals, tout the same thing, tout the great, area to raise a family, mm-hmm. great workforce. And so we need to take a look at what Pennsylvania has different from a number of other states. And one of the things that we have that's different is, just the sheer amount of talent that's coming out of universities, community colleges, a variety of mm-hmm. post-secondary education, or high school education, that really sets us apart from other states. So you look at that, you look at, for manufacturing specifically, there are fixed costs that manufacturers have. And part of what Pennsylvania has to offer is a way to reduce those fixed costs through low-cost energy sources.
Mm-hmm.
We tout Procter & Gamble. Procter & Gamble's largest manufacturing facility in the United States is in Mahoopany, which is in northeastern Pennsylvania. And they're located there, and they're very happy to be there. And one of the reasons is they utilize their own natural gas. They mm-hmm. actually own the rights to the natural gas, and they utilize that to energize their facility. So we can talk about that and opportunities like that to other companies to showcase Pennsylvania as a low-cost state to do business. That really resonates with these groups.
Are there a lot of other metrics you're talking to the site selectors, that people are essentially consultants to companies on
right.
where to go? Do we have a whole set of ways in which we measure, or is it really focused on a strength like you just described?
That's one of them. So,
yeah.
So there are a number of ways, and the one that gets a lot of the attention always are the incentives and things like that. And certainly we have tax credits, low interest rate loans, and
mm-hmm.
even some grants. based upon job creation and investment that they would make in Pennsylvania. But that's not the biggest issue that they look for. They really do look for those low-cost areas, but they also look for talent. Mm. So that's why Pennsylvania also, not only in the central part where Penn State is a huge university, but in the western side, Pittsburgh, Erie, Philadelphia, areas up throughout the Lehigh Valley, they have a tremendous amount of talent. Going back to what I said before, you know, we have 300 universities, colleges, community colleges. That's a lot of talent that we can put out into the workforce that other states simply don't have that ability to do that.
Yeah, you know, Pennsylvania has four AAU universities, top university, recognized by everyone as four of the top 62 in the country, and four in one state is a lot. This is a draw.
It's a draw.
Or it should be.
And we also, so the other thing that we tout is the fact that we have three ports in Pennsylvania, the only state that has a port directly with direct access to the Atlantic Ocean, to the Great Lakes, and also to the Gulf of Mexico through the city of Pittsburgh.
So does this mean now in attracting companies or having people build their companies in Pennsylvania, there is really a lot of location specificity to this?
Yes.
So you have to pitch different things depending on...
Well, that's it. You know, we came out with a slogan for Pennsylvania, which is work smart, live happy. Mm-hmm. And the reason that we have that is that we know that there has to be a great balance, and especially the millennials that are coming into the workforce right now. I have three of them. So, you know, the millennials that are coming into the workforce right now, they demand a good work-life balance. And part of what we need to do, you know, my department is called the Department of Community and Economic Development. Mm-hmm. And the governor is very focused on making sure that we have strong communities to support strong businesses and things like that, and vice versa. You have to have that. So you have to have that great balance. In Pennsylvania, simply because of what we have, we're a large state. We have mountains. We have, you know, the best freshwater beach in the country with Presque Isle Park in Erie. We have skiing, we have winter activities, we have summer activities. There's a lot to do for these young millennials, and that's what they demand. So that's another part of what we can do to promote Pennsylvania.
So should we imagine then that at some point in the future, and maybe you're willing to predict when that would be, that the natural gas industry is going to drive the location of high-demand energy companies to be sitting there right within Pennsylvania? Are we seeking that?
That is a great question. Mm-hmm. And I think what we're doing is we're promoting it. Mm-hmm. So I come from the city of Pittsburgh. I grew up in the city of Pittsburgh. And one of the things that happened in the city of Pittsburgh is that, you know, for years, for century, or over a century, we relied on one industry, and that was the steel industry primarily. Mm-hmm. And when I was going into high school, the steel industry started collapsing, and it was completely collapsed by the time I was out of high school, within a short period of time. Tens of thousands of jobs lost. So the idea is not to concentrate on one industry, but to focus on that and other things that can give us a leg up. So right now, the natural gas industry provides us with a low-cost energy source. We're going to utilize it. We're going to take advantage of it. We want to take advantage. We're a net exporter of natural gas, too, because of the low cost and the abundance of it here. But we want to take advantage of it. So one of the things that we are focused on doing is utilizing natural gas, not just as an energy source, but for downstream activities. So in Beaver County, for the first time ever in the Northeast, there is an ethane cracker facility being built. $6 billion, 6,000 construction jobs, 600 permanent jobs. It's a game changer for the state of Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
And because of that, there are other companies that want to be located near a facility like that.
Mm-hmm.
And if you talk to the people from Royal Dutch Shell, one of the largest corporations in the world, the reason that they selected Pennsylvania and the reason that they selected that particular area is because of the abundance of natural gas, the huge natural gas reserves that are there, but also their customers are there. Their customers are in the Northeast. So previously, that was all being developed and manufactured in the Gulf Coast. And you know, if you look at just the logistics of bringing it from the Gulf Coast to where the market is, which is in the Northeast, it makes much more sense to put the facility there. So we think other plastics manufacturers, other types of manufacturers that want to utilize that. So the low-cost energy source is really one benefit of the natural gas, but there are a number of other things.
Yeah.
But while that's happening, you know, we want to partner with Penn State and other universities on the initiatives that you folks are involved in right now because of the sheer talent that's coming out and the opportunities. Yeah.
So I'd give a pitch for one. Okay. Data centers.
Yeah.
Very high energy utilization, high tech, very clean, high tech employees.
Yes.
I think we should be pitching data centers.
That's a good question. That's a good point. We know, and it's a big issue right now because we've had some data centers that have come to us now looking for opportunities in Pennsylvania. Interestingly enough, because of the climate, sometimes certain areas in Pennsylvania really make sense for data centers because of the cool temperatures and things like that.
Works.
So,
yeah.
Okay.
Plus low cost natural gas.
Good.
So switching gears a little bit, let's think about agriculture. Huge importance. Does this play a role in your thinking?
Absolutely.
Are we at risk? Are we diversifying? What is the future? I don't think most people realize how important it is to the economics of Pennsylvania.
Hugely important. It's one of the largest industries we have in Pennsylvania, agribusiness, and the opportunities are incredible. We talk to the folks in the Department of Agriculture all the time, and Secretary Redding and I speak about this all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So part of what our focus is from the agricultural side and the jobs is trying to keep some of these farms viable, keep some of these farms in families, and really didn't understand this as much until I got into this position. But the fact of the matter is, a lot of these farms are really they could go away like that because, you know, some of the farmers get older, maybe the kids don't want to get into the business.
Yeah.
So one of the things that we do is we have low interest rate loans that we could provide to farmers and to farms to do a variety of other things.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the big things that's happening right now is that a lot of the farms, especially in Central and the Lancaster area, Reading,
right. Yeah.
Or the Lancaster and York counties, and they look at opportunities to have other businesses within the farms. So they'll do other processing facilities like chickens and things like that. So we provide funding to help them put those processes in place, low interest loans, and it is huge. So a lot of the funding that we provide has to have a job creation component, but for agriculture, we suspended that. We don't have a job creation component because of how important it is.
You're preserving.
Absolutely. You know, and looking at, you know, the issues that come along with it and with the Department of Environmental Protection, things like, you know, some of the nitrates that go into the Susquehanna, that go into the Chesapeake Bay, and dealing with issues like that. But it is huge. It is a big part of what we try to do, and we work really closely with the Department of Agriculture.
Yeah. Interestingly, we have a student startup, Deep Roots, it maintains the nutrients and they don't escape in the same
level. Is that right? Okay.
Level.
Great.
Young man just going great guns with
it.
Okay,
good.
I love thinking about the fact that, you know, these bright young minds are going to solve some of these problems. So you mentioned universities in terms of here's a talent pool. And, you know, I often say that we should even be responsive to that. You know, our campuses should go to Shell and say, how can we help you with your workforce? And have this be a very deliberate relationship. But this isn't just workforce creation. Is there sort of a conscious discussion in state government about here's how we get universities to play a deeper role in economic development?
There is. And I think part of what we've discovered at the state level, and particularly within our department, is that we need to have the great relationships with the universities so we can tap into the talent, but also support the universities and what they're trying to do and have the universities support us in what we're trying to do, which is, you know, create jobs, expand the amount of jobs within the area, expand the amount of investment. So part of what we want to do is we want to have that opportunity to work with some of the partners that we have. So we have the Partnership for Regional Economic Performance, or PREP, which are a group of professionals, economic development professionals, that help small businesses start. You know, for some of the entrepreneurs that are coming out of Penn State that want to start a business, so mm-hmm. they can provide support, technical support, and also financial support in some cases. We have the Ben Franklin Technology Development Authority and the Ben Franklin mm-hmm. Partnerships that do a great job. They're fantastic. And they really do. And actually, we're doing a tour after this program. Of some of the small entrepreneurs that are you know hopefully going to grow into large businesses, and it's important for us at the state level to help seed that and to help mm-hmm. create the environment to do that. Mm-hmm. So the governor and you've had a chance to talk to the governor a lot, you know he truly believes in great partnerships with the public sector, and then also our universities. It mm-hmm. has to happen. Mm-hmm. And I think in the past, some of the things that we've seen and we've kind of bemoaned as a state is that, you know, we graduate all these smart young people and they leave Pennsylvania. And what we're trying to do, like with the natural gas, is utilizing mm-hmm. Pennsylvania. We want them to stay here. We want them to have opportunities to stay here, whether that's working for one of our large corporations, medium, small manufacturers, or starting their own company. And we have a lot of smart people. We want to be able to give them the tools that they need to be successful.
Mm-hmm. So Penn State created, not that long ago, Invent Penn State to create a much stronger pathway between our intellectual property and the marketplace, but also really to enable students to take the step as an entrepreneur with us helping them. And about this time next year, we should be cutting the ribbons on the next facilities, and we believe we'll get up to the point where we'll have over 20 incubators and accelerators around the state of Pennsylvania. It's I've really appreciated the degree to which people have gotten very involved, and the communities are getting very involved, and adding more money to it than we were adding. Mm-hmm. But if you step back and you look at it, what do you see, and what do you imagine that it might turn out to be like if we do a good job on our end?
So I have an opportunity to meet with folks like you, President Barron, throughout the state, to meet with manufacturers, to meet with big corporations, small, medium corporations, and the fact that and the opportunities that you're providing through an organization like this and through Invent Penn State and giving a soft landing to some of these kids, young adults that really have tremendous ideas but need some support to be able to get those ideas to the next step in these times where there's student debt issues mm-hmm. and things like that. So they really need a lot of support to be able to take that step. We don't want to lose that opportunity. And if there are opportunities like that, and the private sector is putting money in, the universities are putting money in, and then the public sector, it makes it much easier for the public sector to put more support to that. Mm-hmm. So the other thing is as we go along, judging upon how this goes, and we certainly will look at opportunities to partner with you, with Penn State, through Invent Penn State, further to help provide additional support to these young people that are coming out. Again, we don't want to lose these opportunities.
Yeah.
Great opportunities, smart. I mean, not every idea is gonna come to fruition. We know that.
Yep.
Not every idea is great, but a lot of them are. And we really want to.
I would say public institutions are constantly afraid of failure.
Yeah.
So there's risk here, and some of those 22 may not work out.
Right.
We've told them all, we don't want cookie cutters across the state. We want them to reflect their community needs. And the strengths that they have and the assets that the community brings. But should we be afraid of failure in trying this out?
And this is somebody that comes from, this is coming from somebody that works in the public sector. Mm-hmm. So your failures are front page news. But
They are.
But the issue for us is that we have to encourage that. If we have to take that step, and we have to do that. And I think if we don't do that, again, we're going to lose opportunities.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of smart people that are coming out of the universities right now. We got to give them a chance.
We do.
Yeah.
We do. You know, and as a public university, we feel this obligation to teach and the obligation to publish. I see it as a new thing, as sort of an obligation to get your ideas into the marketplace. That makes a university powerful. I also tell our students, you know, you have a couple of choices here. You can go to Silicon Valley, live in a terrible place, and eat ramen noodles while you start your company. You can stay here in Pennsylvania, eat hamburgers, and right. have a community that supports you, and have a much better living environment than what you might have. I think that it's going to work. We've also come to the conclusion that thinking like an entrepreneur is a good educational experience. What do you think of that message?
I think it's tremendous, and I think that when you think like an entrepreneur, you know, there's a lot of pressure. There's a lot of pressure, but you have an incredible amount of investment in your ideas when you think like that. And I think we all have to kind of step back sometimes and look at the situation and look at the opportunities that are there. And I've been doing economic development and community development for close to 30 years. And I've seen a lot of opportunities squandered, but I also have seen some great opportunities that go to that next level and that next step. And I think we have the ability to do that and the ability to support that. So to hear that, you know, Penn State is doing it in such a big way with Penn State's network of all your branch mm-hmm. campuses around the state is just tremendous. And not only the branch campuses, but your alumni. I think you had told me that your alumni association is bigger than any alumni association.
About 700,000.
So they're
it's a
more than
number.
A few.
It's
yeah.
quite a network.
Right.
And
it's a great
and
network.
We're trying to. We think they're going to support things through philanthropy too, which right. is tremendous. Just sort of encapsulating here your view. What advice would you give to a young entrepreneur in the state of Pennsylvania?
My advice would be to stick with it and look for the opportunities, look for the resources, look for the support network, and look for the way to really take this to the next level. We think you could do it here.
And the state's with you on this.
State's with you 100%.
And support.
Yes.
That's wonderful.
Yes.
Thank you so much for joining the show. It's a
appreciate
great, fun topic to talk about.
It really is. It really is. Thank you.
Next up on Digging Deeper, I'll talk one-on-one with President Barron about his vision for connecting researchers with the marketplace. President Barron, you began Invent Penn State with the goal of, you know, driving economic development by connecting researchers with the marketplace in which they work. Now, we're 2 years into the initiative. What, if anything, would you change? What are your thoughts on that?
You know, I'd have a hard time picking what I would change. It's gone so much faster than I thought. You know, I sort of see a president as sort of applying a little bit of force to go into a direction. But in this case, the community was ready mm-hmm. for someone to say, okay, we need to head in this direction. It wasn't a strength of Penn State, not a lot of investment, but we went with the idea that we would do this in State College and we would pick maybe six Commonwealth campuses. And the next thing you know, we've got the next six Commonwealth campuses that say, well, we've got some ideas, we've got community support, we want to create a incubator, and then it grows, and then the next set, and you know, we have basically startup grants to have people write even stronger proposals. Happy Valley Launchbox in State College. Probably had 20 companies, startups, after a month of opening their door. We're looking at how to expand it. Working hard to attract companies, and we just brought in Morgan Materials Company that fits with our number one ranked materials program here at Penn State. Our friends are starting to donate money that we can then give to students to help them start their companies, or faculty to help start their companies. It is just growing in leaps and bounds. We had little competitions on campus. We're now creating campus-wide competitions. So instead of thinking, you know, what would I change, I'm sort of just smiling because so much is happening because people are investing their own time because they're enjoying doing it and they're being successful.
Starting your business is hard enough, but keeping it afloat is even more challenging. I mean, no matter what numbers we look at, roughly half of new businesses fail within the first year, and then it's even harder to maintain that within 5 years. So what, if any, ongoing assistance does Penn State offer to these startup businesses?
So we've had a lot of worry that we knew there would be a high failure rate. It's part of learning, and I think that education helps everyone. So that's okay, but publics, you're not supposed to fail at these things. So what can you do? Well, you can have a student say they spent the whole summer trying to set up their company legally. Mm-hmm. And here now they have legal aid. They can have boot camps that help them get going. We have minors in entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. There's lots and lots of things like that give our students an advantage.
Okay, good. And it was announced recently that Invent Penn State would be creating a special living option for students with very entrepreneur-like-minded students. So why do you think it was necessary to create this special
living option? It's just an advantage. The idea is if you have a whole density of entrepreneurs, they feed off of each other. Mm-hmm. Oh, you already solved that problem? Oh, okay, so you went to so-and-so? Wait a minute, I have this idea. Wait a minute, I'd love to work with you on that idea. And you create just this energy that students can feed off of each other, and I've already solved that problem, and they make it easier for someone else. So this is just a way of promoting success.
I can't wait to see how it plays out.
Me too.
Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
On behalf of Penn State President Eric Barron, we'd like to thank our guest, Dennis Davin, Pennsylvania Secretary of Community and Economic Development. I'm Kayla Fish. Thanks for joining us.
Support for Digging Deeper comes from the Penn State Alumni Association. Connecting alumni to the university and to each other, the Alumni Association is powered by Pride. Learn more at alumni.psu.edu. The Penn State Bookstore, now in an expanded location in the Hub Robeson Center. Improving the student experience at Penn State with philanthropic support for student causes throughout the university. And from viewers like you. Thank you.